Hi everyone, welcome back to my YouTube videos. In this video, I'm going to solve exercise 4.14 of the textbook, first course in probability. So in this problem, we assume that five distinct numbers are randomly distributed among five players, and they play a game with player one playing against player two. Whoever has the largest number is going to play with player three. They again compare their numbers. Whoever wins, meaning whoever has the largest number is going to play with player four, and so on. So that's again our random experiment. So here the sample space is going to be basically the set of all the possible rankings of the number looking at the player. So you have five factorial possible outcomes in our experiment, but instead of looking again at all the possible outcomes, we want to look at a specific aspect of the experiment and look at the number of times player one is going to win. Okay, so we have a random variable x defined on some sample space omega. Omega is all the possible rankings of the five numbers. That's five factorial. And this one is going to have value in, well, if player one has a smaller number than player two, then player one is going to lose from the beginning. So he's going to win zero time. Then at the opposite, if player one has the largest number, then this player is going to win against everybody else because there are four other players. Player one can win up to four times. So that means that we are dealing with a discrete random variable with a range of size 5 going from 0 to 4. So 0, 1, 2, 3, 4. And the goal is to compute the probability that x equals 0, 1, 2, 3, or 4. So it turns out that so to solve this problem, instead of looking at all the specific ways the numbers can be given to the five players in such a way that player one is going to win zero times, one times, and so on, what I'm going to use is something kind of natural. I mean, it's really a property that follows from the fact that we assume that all five factorial possible permutations of the numbers are equally likely. It's the fact that if instead of looking at all five numbers, you look at only the numbers given to a specific number of players, let's say three players, then if you look at only three players, you have three numbers, so three factorial possible ranking of the three numbers. And because all five factorial possible rankings are equally likely, that also means that all three factorial possible ranking of the numbers given by to three specific players should also be equally likely. So that's like some obvious property that follows by symmetry. If you look at, let's say, a set of n numbers, you have n factorial possible permutation of those numbers. If those permutations are equally likely, and if you look at any possible subsets, then all possible ordering of this subset of the numbers in this subset are also going to be equally likely. So that's what we are going to use to solve the problem. And to be able to write our events explicitly, so the event that x equals 0, x equals 1, and so on up to 4, we can rewrite so these events more specifically using, giving names, giving a name to the numbers that each of the player gets. So I'm going to call ni, so the number for player I, okay? So ni is going to be the number that player I gets. And then we can rewrite all the five events corresponding to the five elements in the range of x using those ones. And then that's going to show that the probabilities we are looking for are probabilities of specific ordering, not of all the ni, but only the first ones, step by step. So let's look at this. So first, what is the probability that x equals 0? So it's px 0. So this one is exactly the probability that player 1 is going to lose against player 2. That means that the number that player 1 got, n1, is less than the number that player 2 got, n2. So that's exactly the probability that n1 is less than n2. But that's where I'm going to use the fact that, well, we don't really need to look at all the possible orderings of the numbers such that n1 is less than n2. That looks complicated. Instead, we can just say, well, we can just say that because all 5 factorial orderings are equally likely by assumption, that means that by symmetry, n1 is less than n2 with the same probability that n2 is less than n1, okay? So that means that here we can just say, well, there are 2 possible orderings of those 2 numbers, okay? 2 factorial equals 2, and we want this specific ordering to happen. So one specific ordering out of 2 factorials equals 2, so that indeed this is true, okay? And so that gives you your probability. So this is equal to just 1/2, okay? That's the first step. Then we are going to use this trick for all the other probabilities. So now, what is the probability that x equals 1, meaning that player 1 is going to win once? This happens in terms of the numbers ni. This happens if player 1 has a larger number than player 2, but a smaller number than player 3. So eventually, that tells you that we need a specific ordering of the first 3 numbers. So this ordering says that n2 should be less than n1. That's to make sure that n1 is going to win the first game, but then we want also n1 less than n3, and that's to make sure that that player 1 is going to lose the second game against player 3. And then again, here you can say that because all 5 factorial possible ordering of those 5 numbers are equally likely, that means that all 3 factorial possible ordering of those 3 numbers that are extracted from the set of 5 should also be equally likely. And so here you have a specific ordering, that's one specific ordering out of 3 factorial equals 6 possible ordering. And so that gives you this this probability is equal to 1 over 6. So 1/6. Okay, that comes from 1 divided by 3 factorial. Then, next step, px2, probability that player 1 is going to win twice. So now things are going to become slightly different, because in this event, we don't have any specific information about the specific ranking between n2 and n3. We don't know if n2 is larger than n3 or n3 is larger than n2. That doesn't matter. What we want to have here is that n1 should be larger than those 2 ones, but less than n4. So I'm going to write this. That's exactly the event that x equals 2. So here we have n2, and I'm just going to put a comma here, and n3 should be less than n1, and n1 should be less than n4. Okay, and so here you see that we have 4 numbers. Again, that gives you 4 factorial possible ordering of those 4 numbers. And so 4 factorial possible ordering. And what we want is one of those 2 possible orderings. So you see that here, because of this, we don't have information about N2 and N3. I mean, it doesn't matter whether N2 is more or less than N3. That gives you 2 specific ordering out of because you have four numbers, four factorial possible ordering. So here it's going to give you a 2 divided by 4 factorial. Okay, 4 factorial is equal to 24. And so 2 divided by 24 is 1 over 12. Okay, so there is a probability 1 12th that player 1 is going to win twice. Okay, then we can continue with the same pattern, px3, probability that player 1 is going to win exactly 3 times. That means that N2, N3, N4 should be less than N1, but N1 should be less than N5. So that's exactly the probability of, let's say, N2, N3, and N4 less than N1, but N1 should be less than N5. And so in this case, because you have 5 numbers, there are like, so now you are using all 5 numbers, there are 5 factorial possible ordering of those numbers, they are equally likely by assumption. And if you look at the total number of possible orderings of those 5 numbers, but in such a way that this condition is satisfied, gives you exactly, well, 3 factorial possible ordering of those ones, and then N1 should be larger and N5 should be even larger. Okay, so you have exactly 3 factorial possible ordering that gives you this condition. So it's 3 factorial possible ordering for those 3, and then N1 and 5. So 3 factorial out of 5 factorial. So here the answer is going to be 3 factorial divided by 5 factorial. This simplifies, that gives you a 1 divided by 5 times 4, that's 20, so that's 1 over 20 here. 1 over 20. And then, last step, px4. I'm going to use the same reasoning to get this last number, but there is another way to think of the problem. In fact, what you can do at this step also is just to say that, well, because those 5 probabilities should add up to 1, you can also say that this 1 must be equal to 1 minus 1 half minus 1 sixth minus 1 twelfth minus 1 20th. But let's redo this reasoning, and then you get that this is exactly the probability that N2, N, N3, N, N4, N, N5 are all less than N1. And then, following the same reasoning, you say that here we have 5 numbers, there are 5 factorial possible ordering of those numbers. All 5 factorial orderings are equally likely, but the number of ordering that gives you this relationship is, well, N1 should be the largest, and then you look at all possible permutation of those 4 numbers, that's 4 factorial, and so eventually here you get 4 factorial divided by 5 factorial. This simplifies, that gives you a 1/5. Okay, so it's 1/5 at the end. You can check again that all those 5 numbers indeed add up to 1. And one last comment about the last one. Well, in fact, to get the probability that that x equals 4, so meaning that the first player is going to win all the times, in fact, you can get this 1/5 more easily by just using something that we would call a symmetry argument. Exactly, x equals 4 means exactly that, again, player 1 is going to win against the other 4 players. So that's exactly the event that player 1 got the largest number at the first place. But because we assume that all the orderings are equally likely, that also means that each of the 5 players is equally likely to get at the first place the largest number. And so that means that the one with the largest number is going to be player 1 or 2 or 3 or so on up to 5 with probability 1/5. That's where this 1/5 comes from. 1/5 is clearly also the probability that the largest number at the first place was given to player 1.